100,000 population just in Dayu City. The entire area has a few million people. When they talk about a city, they talk about the area. So it's a pretty large area and a pretty good population. The major industry is ore mining and ore processing and farming, agriculture. That's about all they do in that area as far as employment. Ken? Go on. Which way do we go here? Okay.
Wrong way.
Not that way. Do I have to point this at something? There we go. Okay, there we go. That's time. Go ahead.
Okay, like Alex said, just the trip itself, the travel is very difficult. It's not an easy trip. It's not one that anybody can do.
It's about 8,000 miles one way to get there. And then we get there, like I said, we fly into Shanghai, then we take another train, we take buses, you name the transportation, you know, if we're riding a donkey, we'd ride a donkey. I mean, so to get to where we were going this particular time, like I said, we're in the Hebei province. This was my seventh trip, and I have to say probably the most poorest region we've ever been to. I mean, they're all poor, but this was, China is one of those, they have very modern cities. Shanghai is as modern as any city there is. But the second you leave that city, you're immediately into third world. I mean, it's very, very poor. There's no middle in China. You're either rich or you're poor. Middle class doesn't even, very little exists in China.
And where we're at, that's right where we're at, is right there near Wuhan. So Wuhan's a big city, relatively. I mean, it's 8 million, 7 million people. It's a very large city. Yeah. Okay. Next slide, please. This is not working, obviously. Maybe it is. Go ahead, Ken.
Okay, so as far as this particular trip, this is what we delivered almost 13,000 Bibles. We wanted to do just a little bit more, but the price of some of the Bibles that we had to get were a little bit more than what we anticipated when we first started. So, but we still almost we came up with 12,750 Bibles that were being distributed.
And always, I always say potentially 12,750 souls or more, because they read their Bible. Believe it or not, people get a Bible, they actually read it, and they share it with their families, they share it with their friends. It's amazing. This is not working. There we go.
Yeah.
Maybe it is. This is Ken, you know, Mr. what's his name?
Wu.
Wu, yeah, Mr. Wu. Li Ping Martinez is from Word for Asia. We work with them because they set up all the logistics for us. They take care of the translators. They take care of the planning for the trips. They work with the local people like Mr. Wu, who's in charge of 600,000 Christians in Dayu City all around the area. 600,000 that claim Christianity, 200,000 of which are actual underground family churches, and I'll explain a little bit about that later on. But he's responsible for all those preaching points and all those buildings and all those churches.
For the entire
there.
Province.
Yep.
He's the head.
And Mr. Wu was just tremendous with us. He's a joy to be with, and he really liked he liked some of the things that we were saying, and he liked the things that we liked the things that he was saying. That is not working. I'm sorry.
So of course he wasn't camera shy at all, Mr. Wu.
Never.
But he was responsible for our travel, for our housing, for everything for while we were in his care. So he was a very good host. And I just wanted to see a good on this picture. If you see, he's opening the Bible. You see how it's stamped? Every single Bible is stamped and verified as part of this effort that we do. So we make sure that you'll see other pictures where we have the distribution of the box. Every single Bible is counted and verified when we hand it out.
So you can be sure that every dollar that goes toward Bibles gets spent on a Bible. It doesn't take care of expenses. It doesn't take care of travel. It is strictly for Bibles. When you give for Bibles for China, every dollar goes to a Bible. And right now, they cost roughly about $3 a piece. We get them for a little less, the smaller ones. The larger ones, we had to pay a little bit more. So about the average is about $3 a Bible. It's amazing. And if you'll notice, they actually read their Bible. You hand out the Bible. You're not even through halfway through the distribution. People are opening up the scriptures to see what it says. It's amazing.
And again, they love to take pictures. So everywhere we stop, these are people that are helping. And a lot of the people that you see in this picture, they will travel with us to every single stop. And they're always there to help us. So they're very grateful that we're there to hand out these Bibles.
And we were way out in the countryside. You'll see several pictures like this. There's China 1 and 2, which we're most familiar with, like Shanghai, the business, you know, people are making money, they're in business and education, etc. That's China 1 and 2. Then there's China 3 and 4 that's kind of on the outskirts of that. Incomes maybe a few thousand dollars a year, maybe 10 or 12 or 1,000 that we can relate in dollars. We go to 5 and 6, where average income is about $300 a year. Because these people don't have access to the scriptures, and they don't have the money to spend even $3 on a Bible. It's really serious. So that's where
And just for example, where this picture is being taken, we had to park our car, and we probably walked about a half a mile on the side of the village I've seen bike paths bigger than this path that we had to walk on. And then this church was at the very end, outskirts of this village. And this is the picture looking back out to the mountain.
Yeah,
we were at the very end of this village, and we probably walked about a half a mile to get there.
And people come there. I mean, there's hundreds of people that come to the buildings to worship God. It's amazing, and they walk for miles and miles. And there's Li Ping. She's always translating for me. I got to preach to about 2,000 people this time. We had about 3 stops a day, which is a little less than average, but there were hundreds of people always. There were many, many, many people that were there all the time. And like I said, it's the things that I preach is ABC, always pray, Bible study, daily church attendance. So I use ABC. And also tell them if they get a Bible, they read their Bible every day, we'll see them in heaven. And obey it. I stress to obey it. I met with many of the drivers too. Say, that's not working. Okay. Did I say we were out in the countryside? Yeah. We were way out there. You guys all have washing machines at home? This is a washing machine. This is an automatic washer. We were driving by and I said, stop! I got to take a picture. This is an automatic washer. And she was kind of interesting because she's going, why are you taking my picture? We're out in the countryside. And this is a washer and dryer.
Yeah, that's there the dryer. It
is. That's a dryer. Yeah. So you count yourself blessed if you have access to a washer and a dryer. These congregations, I mean, it was Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. That's usually when we go out and distribute Bibles. Most of them are women because most of the men are out working. We're kind of encouraged too that Mr. Wu said that there were many more men that were entering the ministry, and we're starting to develop more men in the leadership. We'll talk about the TSPM church as well. I can't see that very well, but these are some of the ladies that took care of us, and they always had. They always had something, even if it was just water. I mean, that was great. They always made a great lunch for us. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was super.
So this is the hotel that we were staying in Wuhan. This, I believe, is a morning shot. This is the morning. And when they talk about smog in China, it's, I wouldn't call it smog.
It's bad.
It's bad, and again, this is a morning picture that it should be clear, but it's not, and so you just, sometimes it's, if you have asthma, don't go to China.
Yeah. The government officials say, their official line is, you can't trust any air you can't see. That's their, you can't trust it. And then this is a modern kitchen for them. Take a look around. These are some of the ladies that were preparing the meals for us. You don't ask too many questions when you eat. You just eat whatever's provided. You don't ask. You know, and if something's not so good, you just say, they ask you, well, how do you like? And we say, it's interesting. It's interesting. And they emphasize that they read their scriptures. Go ahead, Ken.
Yeah, so you see, there's a box of Bibles down here. So all the Bibles are distributed to a central location, and then from there, then we distribute out to what they call the preaching points. This is a preaching point, and like I said, it could be 10 o'clock on a Friday morning, and we'll show up somewhere, and you think you're in the middle of nowhere, and there'll be, you know, 300, 400, 500 people there to get a Bible.
But it's always interesting that they actually get their Bibles and read them. You know, we have access to a Bible anywhere we are. I've got my Bible on my phone. It's with me all the time, unless I leave it in the car. But it's accessible. I mean, that's how privileged we are and how much we should be thinking about having those scriptures with us and how precious God's Word is. They start reading it right away.
Yeah, so we distribute to every person that shows up. They get a Bible, and like I said, we can see here. I mean, I'm still distributing, and they're already reading the Bible. I mean, they are so grateful to get that Bible. I can't even put into words.
Again, just emphasizing, they do read their scriptures. They want to see what's in the Bible.
All right. So real quick about this gentleman, information that we gathered through our translator. This gentleman is 92 years old, totally blind in one eye, and he told the translator he could still read with one eye, and he wanted that Bible. So 92 years old, the first Bible he's ever owned.
Yep, it's precious. It almost brings you to tears. I'm serious. It is amazing. Did I tell you we're out in the countryside? We're driving on the road, and this buffalo was, I'm serious, about an arm's length away from the outside of the window. I'm telling you.
And you wonder why we can't get anywhere. We're always stopping.
Yeah, well, it's true. And, of course, I get to preach to a few thousand people. I'm not shy either. Yeah.
So, again, this was one of the distribution places. So we can see, like I say, one of the jobs that I do when I'm there is I make sure that I verify the Bibles that when they get distributed, we count, we verify, we do everything that we can possibly to make sure that we have, that it matches our invoice, that these are the number of the Bibles that we're distributing.
And that's really mostly for us, and it's also for you, because when you give your money to something, you want to make sure that money is being spent for Bibles. So we want to make sure that, you know, that's why we work with Word for Asia, because they hire college students and high school students to stamp every single one of those Bibles. They pack them in cases, and those cases are shipped to a central area, and they get counted. And we get to see, we got to see most of them this time, because I've got the inventories for all the Bibles. We had to have two teams to distribute 12,750 Bibles. So there was another team, Gene Wood, who's president of the Word for Asia, mm-hmm. and his team, his wife Carol, distributed the other Bibles that we couldn't. So we can handle about 6,000 to 8,000 Bibles personally on one team in an area. And we never go to any area twice. We always go to different preaching points and different places in the country. It's so vast, 1.5 billion people. And this is, it's just a drop in the bucket.
And this is their distribution truck, by
yeah.
the way.
They load them up and get them out. These are some of the drivers that were there. And my instruction to them, again, is to tell the people, when you hand out these Bibles, because we can't be everywhere all the time, hand out those Bibles, tell them to read it and obey it, and we'll see you in heaven. If they'll read their Bible, just like we all have, and if we obey it, we'll be in heaven.
So, and again, this is just part of the distribution. Now, part of their culture there is when you give something away, it's always with two hands. You don't just throw it around. So we always were very mindful of and very respectful of their culture.
This young lady, she came because her grandmother told her to come. She had no real idea.
This is her first
there.
Time in a church.
First time she's ever been in a church building, period. And so Li Ping says, why don't you tell her about the gospel message? And I said, I will. So her and I walked out the side door, and she spoke English fluently. Perfect English. Really, really great. I talked to her about Christ. I talked to her about the existence of God. Went through the entire presentation in probably 7 minutes while we were outside. And she said she's very interested, and she's going to take this Bible and read it. And I said, we'll pray for you. Absolutely. Her name was Vicky. She took an English name. I think it's Vicky.
All give themselves English
names. Yeah, they give themselves English names. So. But she was going to read her Bible and talk to her grandmother. So that was fantastic. Like I said, they read their Bible. And they read their Bible. Do we read our Bible? There's a little piece in there that that they have 100 scriptures, 50 from the New Testament and 50 from the Old, that they have printed up. That's a word for Asia, puts in every one of the Bibles. A lot of the references are just terrific. Some of the scriptures that we all know that are very familiar. But they have 50 New Testament, 50 Old Testament. And I looked at it, too, to make sure. I had a translator a couple of years ago when they were handing those out to make sure that the plan of salvation is in there, all the scriptures that relate to it. And it is. And, of course, we always have a photo op. And the preaching points, they bring the Bibles, like I said, in those small trucks. They bring them out, and we get to distribute them at the preaching points. Ken, you want to talk about that?
No, this is yours.
This is a modern ceramic bathroom.
It's a stand-up.
Yeah, it's a.
And this is modern.
It is. With ceramic, it's wonderful. And see the little red bag in the top? That's where your paper goes after you're done. Just a quick slide. And the kids are great. Go ahead.
For whatever reason, I don't know if it was the region that we're in. Again, I know they're always grateful that we're there, but we prayed for a lot of people came up to us with different things, and they wanted us to pray for them. I mean, they wouldn't leave until we prayed with them. So we had a lot of hugs and a lot of prayers on this trip.
Yeah, and men, women, children, everybody just was so friendly and so outgoing. It was just fantastic, and they were so appreciative that we were there to give them a Bible.
Right.
And you're part of that. You're part of the joy those people feel when they get the scriptures in their hands. It's amazing.
Youth worship. They do youth yeah. worship in China.
They did.
We were in the main... fellowship hall or main, just like here, and I happened to see out the door on the other side of the compound, but it wasn't the driveway, but there was a small, real small building, and I noticed that's where all the kids were. They were doing a youth worship, just like we would do here. So, of course, Alex and I, when we were done here, we ran right over there because we wanted to be involved with that too. So this is a youth worship in China. I thought it was pretty good.
And they sang us their version of Jesus Loves Me. It was great. Did I mention we were way out in the countryside? This lady is getting water into her house. There's no running water. It was just there. She had a couple buckets on her shoulder, and that's how they get water to their house. So just to give you an idea of where we were. And I tell you, they read their Bible, even the kids. Then we had some entertainment, too. Let me talk about the entertainment, Ken.
In fact, this was the very last stop we were at on the Bible distribution. And they actually had a group that attended church, that attends that church, that they actually do weddings and funerals. And they dress up in classic Chinese outfits, and they have this, routine.
It's a percussion, percussion band is what it is.
And so they asked us after worship service, could they do, because Alex and I were there, and we're like, sure. This was the last stop. It was the end of the day, so... So they actually did this after the service. It lasted about 20 minutes and it was pretty cool. I mean, something you don't see every day, I guess. But
it was interesting.
It was
that
interesting.
That beat lasted in my head for like 3 days. I show this picture because we're back in Beijing, and these couples on the end are from London. Phil on the very far right-hand side, now our distribution's done, we're back, this is an exit dinner basically, it's a debriefing dinner, and we get together and have a nice dinner with some of the teams that were in China. They came from London, and Phil has been there several years, he's done this many, many times. Phil is the one on the extreme right, his wife is next to him and this other couple that were there. I show you this picture because of one thing. Plans, the best made plans can go awry. 1 week before they were to distribute Bibles in a different province, north of the Hubei province, 1 week before, one of the people from that province called Word for Asia and said, we're not doing the distribution. 1 week before, the people from London are all booked and ready to go. are wanting to come and distribute Bibles, 1 week before they get a call and say, we're not doing this. There's a lot of layers of bureaucracy in order to get these Bibles into people's hands, and that's where your prayers come in handy, because it only takes one person in the provincial line or anything, one provincial leader, a local leader, the CCC, the Chinese Christian Council, any of those people can say no. Any one person could get a bug in their ear and say, no, we're not doing this. And somebody said, we're not doing this. So here they have 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 Bibles stacked up in a place that they can't distribute them. So they had to see, Word for Asia arranged to have a truck to pick them all up, take them to a different province. Actually, they distributed them in the northern part of Hubei province, which was, you know, friendly territory. And they were able to come in and fly in and do the distribution. And that's what's really great about the things that, you know, that Word for Asia does for us, is that they handle all those logistics and make sure the Bibles get distributed. And even with that kind of a hiccup, 1 week before, they were able to take care of it. And of course, it's Christmas in China when we were there. Merry Christmas is said all the time. Doesn't matter. We can't say it here, but they say it there. That's where Ken and I go for coffee every morning when we're in Guangzhou. Mm-hmm. Back up one. This is Anna. I study with her. I baptized her a couple years ago. Actually, I flew to Washington because she was in Washington having a class, and I flew to Washington and baptized her. Tony is her son. He's had cancer for 2 years. 2 years now. Yeah. We've been praying for him.
He just turned 16.
And he still has cancer, and they're still working on it. He goes to chemotherapy about like once every couple months. And his dad, I baptized Riven. I baptized Tony. When we were in Beijing, it just so happens last year that the hotel we stayed at, first time, had an indoor pool. Isn't that lucky? And Riven and Tony and Anna were there in one of the hospitals in Beijing, only about 20 minutes, maybe two or three subway stops away, because he was having treatments in a hospital in Beijing. So I arranged to meet them at the hotel. We had about an hour and a half in the morning. We had time slots. So I studied with both of them. Anna's been studying with her husband and her son, and we were able to get in the pool together and baptize both Riven and Tony. So this is an entire Christian family right here. And Ken's so happy. Back in Guangzhou, of course, we always have, some of the folks that came. Wendy's in the middle. Jenny, I baptized her back in 2009, the very first time she came. And she was baptized in basically a bathtub in our hotel when Cliff was there. And we baptized her. Now, Wendy is really close. Keep praying for Wendy. Mm-hmm. She understands what she needs to do, but her whole family was out of town, so she wanted her family there. And Liu is a Buddhist.
Yeah, she didn't have an American name, but yeah. Most of them are there are Buddhists, yep. And they'll come to these Bible studies. So it's good to know that background, because that helps us when we do Bible studies with them, and because we can ask the right questions, and that's always interesting when you're studying with a Buddhist.
And Jade was living in the United States for 3 years. She was here in Oklahoma City teaching English as a second language, and now she's back in Guangzhou, and she translates for us. And of course, Wendy, Jenny is very fluent in English. She does a great job. And this guy is a son. Well, he's a son of her father's friend. And he wants him to get together with Jade because she's still single. But Jade says he's not a Christian. Yeah. I'm not doing that.
But if it gets him to Bible study.
Yeah, we studied with him. Yeah, next. Next.
You hit the button.
I did. There we go. This is where the church meets. One of the house churches in Guangzhou. We were invited. I was invited to preach. And this is some of the folks that are there in Guangzhou. And they meet just in a little small conference room in a hotel. Or in an apartment building. Mm-hmm. You know, that's about it. This is the church. This is a family church.
I think it was about 20.
Yeah, about 20,
about
21, 20. something like that.
That's Sunday morning.
Next. There they are. And some people that are in this group, in this picture, I've known for several years. Jonah in the middle is a preacher there. I just lost her name. Anyway, she's on the end here. I've got her in my WeChat. But several people I've known for many years now. But happened to be that my translator for the group, because there's some people don't speak English, was named Jeff. And Jeff and his wife were in Guangzhou. They had studied in the United States, and they met in the U.S. and they got married. And I said, really, where'd you study? He said, oh, in a small town called Searcy, Arkansas. I said, really? I said, wouldn't happen to be Harding University. He says, well, yeah. Here I am, 8,000, we're 8,000 miles away from home. Here's a couple, general is translating for me. Isn't it lucky?
And to get to this house church, I mean, we had to take a couple of subway stops. I mean, we're really in the middle of nowhere in Guangzhou, and we ran across these two people that both graduated from Harding University. Yep. So, that was just by chance.
I think. Isn't that lucky? Next. There we go.
Oh, who's that guy?
Yeah, we know that guy. Real quickly, we went to Sun Yat-sen University. It's one of the largest and oldest universities in Guangzhou. I like to go there because one of my hobbies is photography, and the venue is fantastic. It's a great place to take pictures, and it's a good place to get some exercise. Great place to take pictures, like I said. If it were sunny, it would be better. I took this picture of these two young ladies. It just looked great. I mean, the canopy and everything else. I just liked the picture. Well, it just so happened they stopped, and I ran up to them with my camera and showed them the picture that I just took. Well, the one young lady on the right was fluent in English. Her name was Helix. Next. Helix is on the right, and her friend, I don't remember her friend's name, but Helix spoke English very, very well. And we started talking about God, and we were trying to figure out where she was, and she really didn't know much about God. So we talked to her a little bit about God and in his existence and his creation of the world. And, you know, we took this picture, and it was great, and we said our goodbyes, and, you know, Sai Chen, and away we went. Well, Ken and I got, you know, being a little older, we got tired and sat on the wall going out. One more.
This is a very, very large,
huge university. We probably walked 5 miles that day, literally, and we were real tired by the time. So we sat down on this little half wall, and who should come back but Helix? She said, I want to know more about God. I went, yes, yes. So I think God placed us in that place in the Sun Yat-sen University just to talk to her. And I've got her email address. I've communicated with her several times. So I'd like to be able to get somebody there before she graduates to get her a Bible. So that's what we're working on. Okay. That's the end of our presentation as far as Bibles for China. I do have a lesson as well, and I'll work on that. Thank you so much, Ken. Ken is just a great, great, great help for me. It's he's done such a great job of being there and making sure logistics are taken care of for me personally. And when sometimes in Guangzhou we have to split up because we have two different levels of study, people that are studying, those that have never known God and others that are Christians for years. We can't put them in the same group, so we may break up, and Ken's a great Bible teacher. Okay. Mind your head. Oops, back up one. There you go. I see this sign a lot. You know, when I go to China, I always look for a sign, not heavenly sign, but a sign, something that, you know, they'll spark the interest. Last time I was doing a lesson on change, and I saw a sign that had a lot of directions on it. Well, this sign is just about everywhere. It's on the escalators going through the metro in Guangzhou. It was here in this very high area. You'd have to be Yao Ming or higher in order to bump your head, but everywhere they put these signs, so to protect themselves and protect the government, I think. But it's mind your head. And I said, there's a lesson in that. In Colossians, the second chapter, we do read, so that just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him. What does it mean to have Christ as Lord? That means to have him be your head, to be your authority, to be an authority in your life. He must be. He must be. To live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Wow. I was putting this together around Thanksgiving, and then I was thinking, that's how we need to live. We need to have Christ as our authority and to live thankfully, to live with thankfulness in our heart, to be grateful of all the things that God provides us. As simple as a Bible that many people take for granted, in China, they hold it precious. They take this Bible, and this is just basically like the ones we handed out, and they take it and they hug it and they read it. And that's amazing, because they want to make Christ their Lord. They want to live with, you know, overflowing. They want to live in faith, overflowing with thankfulness. Next slide, please. Next slide. in Romans, you know, it's amazing. And I don't mean to offend anyone with some of these slides you're going to see in the near future here, but I grew up in the Orthodox faith, in the Orthodox church. It was Serbian Orthodox, but you can add any nationality you want, Romanian, Serbian, Armenian, any Orthodox background. Basically, that is exactly the same. And I came to realize when I was starting to study over a 7-year period that maybe some of the things that the Orthodox Church believed wasn't quite true. And I did a lot of research on what exactly was true and not true. We got to remember there's always two forces at work in this world. There's always two forces. There's God and there's Satan. And Satan can be a great deceiver, a fantastic deceiver. He can make you think that things are just perfect and everything's okay. And it may not be okay. You know, in the 40s, there was my mom used to quote it all the time. She listened to the radio programs, The Shadow. Anybody know about The Shadow? If you're younger than, you know, my age, you probably don't remember. Or it's just my mom used to listen to the programs. And says, the shadow knows what evil lurks in the hearts of men. The shadow knows. That was the big line. Remember, maybe your parents probably said something like that to some of you. What evil lies in the hearts of men? It's amazing. I pray for those that were lost loved ones in the recent shooting in Fort Lauderdale, because we have no idea what evil lurks in the hearts of men. That's why we need Christ so desperately. We need to hold faithful to his word, to make him Lord of our life, to counteract Satan, and he can deceive us too. In Romans, the 12th chapter, 9 to 13 says, love must be sincere, hate what's evil, and cling to what's good. Be devoted to one another, honor one another above yourselves, never lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you, and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Mind your head. Not only your physical head, but your mind. Mind your mind. Mind your head. Mind your authority, who Christ should be your authority. Well, see to it that no one takes you captive through the hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition, the spiritual forces in this world, rather than on Christ. I always, you know, Cliff Tucker used to tease with one of our members, and she'd say something, and she'd say, I think that's in the Bible, and he goes, no, I think that's Shakespeare. But anyway, we've got to look at the scriptures and read it and make sure that we know what's in there, and we are not deceived by Satan. We're not taken away by hollow deception. This is great. One more. I'll go through this quickly. In the Orthodox Church, there's lots of traditions. The robes and all those things are amazing, that they look just like what's written in Exodus and in Leviticus. And it looks like they've taken those traditions and impugned Christ on it and taken those on as something that you need to do and must do. It's wonderful to search out knowledge. It's great to know everything. But if you don't submit to the authority, to the head, which is Jesus Christ, knowledge does you no good. Money is certainly a wonderful tool, but that can become a god unto itself. And, of course, traditions of men, we cannot abide by them. That's why we keep telling the churches in Guangzhou and other places. We say, what are you going to follow? Are you going to follow the scriptures? Or are you going to follow the traditions of men? And that's always the question. We have to ask ourselves, too. Are we going to mind our head? Are we going to mind the authority of Christ himself? Are we going to mind the authority of the scriptures or the traditions made by men? Boy, I don't know about you, but I want to mind my head. You've got to ask yourself, who or what's the authority? 1 Corinthians states that Christ is the head of every man. Christ is the authority over every power and authority, even world powers, even our government, even our church. How about you and me? Let's not forget who's in charge. Let's mind our head and go forward in faith and in Christ as Lord. You know, this could be your day. You must, we talk about it all the time, even in China. You must hear the good news. You must hear that Christ died for you, that Christ lived, that he preached, he talked about all the things we need to do. You got to hear the gospel, the good news that Christ died for you and that he rose from the grave and he lives today. You got to hear the message, hear the good news. One more. Believe that Jesus is the Christ. Believe that he is who he said he was. We talk about that too whenever we preach about God. We talk about the existence of God, but then we go into Christ. You must repent and turn to God. We got to turn 180 degrees and change our thinking. We've got to mind our head. And, you know, if we're not Christians today, that's something we've got to think about. Who's our authority and what's really important? If our authority is not Christ, then we got to think about that. We got to mind our head. Repent and turn to God. In other words, do something different than you're doing today and look at what God wants you to do. You must confess Jesus is Lord, and that's something that might be in your life today. You need to confess that Jesus is Lord and make him your Lord and mind your head and follow him as your head being his authority. And, of course, confess Jesus is Lord and be immersed for the forgiveness of your sins. In China, we do it sometimes we do it in a humble bathtub, and we got to push them down and get them all under. But we know they've submitted to the Lordship of Christ. Have you today? Have you submitted to the Lordship of Christ? Has you made him your head as far as the authority? Have you made the scriptures your guide and resolved? This is a new year. We make all kinds of resolutions. Resolve to make Christ your head. So my message is ABC, always pray, Bible study daily, church attendance, and read your Bible and obey it, and you'll see you in heaven. If you're subject to the invitation today in any way, if you've not submitted to the authority of Christ and done all these things, I think today is the day you might be able to submit to Christ and live as Christ and live as a new creature in Christ. If you have struggles and you want to come forward, the church is here to pray with you. The church is here for your support. We're a family. We're a hospital for the souls, and we need each other. So if you're subject to the invitation in any way, please come forward now as we stand and pray and sing.